welcome. So today, me and my teammate will present our main findings on the topic of whistleblowing, and we chose Cahaya Mata Sarawak Berhad as the company that we studied on. But before that, let me introduce our team members. First is me, Hani Zulaika, followed by Nur Amira Husna, and the next one is Amira Natasha, Siti Nur Amira, and lastly Hani Ariana. Okay, the first one is the introduction to whistleblowing. So, whistleblowing is a voluntary act of reporting any misconduct or unethical behavior within the organization to internal or the external party. And the one who actually make the exposure or disclosure of the wrongdoing is called whistleblower. Okay, so whistleblowing is also have several benefits and also disadvantages. Okay, so for the advantages, we have two, which is the first one, it helps to expose any unethical behavior and unethical activities that happening in the organization. And actually, it will help to put a stop to a deep-rooted company's wrongdoing, so that the company will actually acknowledge what is going on with what is happening in the organization, and also it will serve as a warning to other organization to not do the same thing. And the second benefit is that it will help to refine rules of company financial reporting, because people will demand on more transparency and also disclosure to make, so that the stakeholder will actually maintain their confidence in the company. And the only actually disadvantages of whistleblowing is that the whistleblower might face retaliation from the management, such as being suspended or getting harassed, and also the management actually will perceive the whistleblower as a disloyal person to the company itself. So basically, whistleblowing, they have their importance because they act as a safeguard to protect the stakeholder interests, include the employee and also the public, and also it will help to support the transparency in organization, so that any wrongdoings will get exposed, and it will help to have a good culture in the organization. Okay, next is the overview of Whistleblower Protection Act 2010 that we have in Malaysia. So this act is being enforced on 15 December 2010, and it aims actually to provide protection to the whistleblower, and also act as to combat actually any wrongdoings happening in the companies in Malaysia. So actually, to be able to be protected under this act, the whistleblower actually they have their own terms of protection, which is first, they are willing to be identified by the enforcement agency, and then they have to personally meet the officers in charge, and also they must reveal their identity and address in manner that actually he can be contacted. Because when someone make a report or complaint to the enforcement agency, they must follow up with an investigation regarding the complaints to make sure that the report made is legit, and also actually they have proof of the wrongdoings that is happening. Okay, under this act also, they have three forms of protection. The first one is the protection of confidential information of the whistleblower, and also for the person that the whistleblower made report of, and also the information regarding the complaint made. And also they are immune from any civil and also criminal actions. And lastly, they are protected against detrimental action, which means the detrimental is that the action that actually will cause injuries to the whistleblower.
My name is Hani Adana, and I would like to proceed the presentations to discuss on the background of Cahaya Mata Sarawak Berhad as part of the main findings and discussion on current issue. Cahaya Mata Sarawak Berhad is the Sarawak first cement manufacturer. It is a leading corporation listed on the main market Malaysia Stock Exchange, Bursa Malaysia. The evolution of this company begins in 1974, where from a single produce manufacturer to now become a corporation with the vision to be the pride of Sarawak and beyond. Previously, CMS is known as Cement Manufacturer Sarawak Berhad, now changed its name to Cahaya Mata Sarawak in 1996 due to the rapid diversification made by them. The missions of Cahaya Mata Sarawak stands for pride, which brings meaningful meaning for each mission, where the P is for producing quality, R is for respect, I is for improving, innovating and investing in people, D is for delivering sustainable growth, and E is for environmental conscious care and conducive workplace. Currently, Cahaya Mata Sarawak portfolio has spread over 35 countries, include the cement manufacturing, trading, telco infrastructure, education and other services. The company is committed to explore and grab various opportunities of business to maximize its participation in the Sarawak growth timeline.
Hi everyone, my name is Nur Amir Husna binti Muhammad Nazri, and I will proceed with the story of whistleblowing in Cahaya Mata Sarawak, or we call as CMS. So the story begins when CMS reported to the authorities in regards to the allegations of conflict of interest, which involved the director and deputy group chairman, Datuk Sri Mahmud Abu Bakir Taib, and former chief information officer, Carl Vink. It is said that the allegations were received through the group's whistleblower channel. So what we discovered is that the majority of alleged issues are connected to the duo's interest in a company called Vienna Advantage. What happened is that Vienna Advantage is appointed to replace CMS existing ERP software. However, the appointment of Vienna Advantage is initiated by CMS Digital Transformation Program Chairman, Datuk Sri Mahmud and Carl Vink. Both of them have their interest in Vienna, where they actually have their own control in Silver Lining Systems, which holds 60% control of Vienna Advantage. So to sum up, CMS CIO Carl Vink recommended Vienna's ERP to CMS. Meanwhile, the one who approved the replacement of CMS existing ERP to Vienna's ERP is the chairman of Digital Transformation Committee, Datuk Sri Mahmud himself. This is clearly shown that the arising of conflict of interest of Datuk Sri Mahmud and Carl Vink that made the whistleblower to come ahead to lodge the allegations through the whistleblower channel. Alright, so basically this is the storyline where in April, Datuk Sri Mahmud was seeking a leave of absence from all his positions in the group. Then, later in May, Chief Financial Officer of CMS, Syed Hizam Asagov, is announced to be suspended for 30 days to facilitate the process of investigations of the possible financial mismanagement in the company. Alright, so while in June, CMS has appointed KPMG Management and Risk Consulting Sendirian Berhad as the independent consultant to investigate the allegations of financial mismanagement of the company's investments and operations. Alright, now we will relate the story just now with the company's whistleblowing policy. But I don't think we can see the policies properly in the slides, so let me zoom a bit. Alright, that's better. Okay guys, so based on the policy, it is stated that any employee can blow the whistle in regards to any suspected misconduct such as fraud, misappropriation, abuse of authority, corrupt practices or any other form of contravention or non-compliance with the company's policies and procedures. Hence, all employees of CMS are encouraged to raise their concerns and lodge a report either verbally or written if there is any action that is illegal or unethical is suspected within the company. So it is also stated that the identity of the whistleblower shall not be revealed and the company will keep the confidentiality of the identity at all times to protect the whistleblower. Alright, in the case of CMS, the whistleblower believed that there is an arising of conflict of interest of deputy group chairman, Datuk Sri Mahmud and former CIO, Carl Vink, linked to their interest in Vienna Advantage. So this issue could lead to acts of misconduct where it may violate the company's policies and procedures, statutory laws, acts or regulations. Therefore, the whistleblower raised the issue and lodged the report to the designated channel. So as a result, a full investigation has been carried out accordingly to protect the interests of the company and its stakeholders. And besides, the confidentiality of the whistleblower identity is also being kept at all times as promised. Therefore, we believe that the company is committed to the high standards of ethical, moral and legal business conduct as stated in their whistleblowing policy as they apply the policy effectively for this case. So that's all from me. I'll pass to the next presenter. Thank you.
Assalamualaikum. My name is Siti Noor Mirmetikari Faizi and I'll proceed with the internal audit rules in relation to the whistleblowing. So internal auditors can serve as a whistleblower since they have access to critical information that could have a negative influence on the firm. So as a result, there are two areas of internal audit activity that need to be considered in relation to the whistleblowing, which is at triage and also during investigation. So the first one is acting in a triage role. So internal auditors should take a risk-based approach by acknowledging all reports, responding to them as quickly as as possible prioritized action on the reports depending on the risk. That's not to say that some of the reports are not serious, but there may be others that are more critical and should be prioritized. So furthermore, internal auditors could outsource the complaints involving misunderstandings, small errors or personal grievances to a support group such as human resource department that could address them more effectively. So besides acting in a triage role, being an investigator also is deemed an internal audit role in relation to whistleblowing. So internal auditors should commit to thoroughly, fairly, rapidly and discreetly reviewing all the concerns, making suggestions for further action and also liaising with authorities where criminality is suspected. So most crucial part is where where the whistleblower's identity is known. Provide feedback to them. They should be kept up to date on the progress and also outcome of the report so that they are aware of the current situation. So furthermore, while internal audit has indirect responsibility in administering the whistleblowing process, it also should provide assurance to the board of directors on the effectiveness of the procedure and retain the authority to receive all the whistleblowing reports. This is because the reports will allow the internal auditor to investigate the issues reported and provide assurance on the organization's internal control. As a recommendation, we can see that Chai Mata Sarawak's internal auditor is not doing a good job in regards to the company's whistleblowing activity, as the whistleblower had to direct his or her report to the external parties. The statement provided shows that the internal auditor does not accept the whistleblower's whistle, necessitating the whistle to be blown to the outside parties. As the internal auditors of the company, they must quickly respond to the report made by the employees by thoroughly investigating the matters without being influenced and maintain their objectivity. When there is enough credible evidence that the wrongdoer has committed the crime, the internal auditor should notify the audit committee so that further action can be taken. As a result, the company was able to address the situation internally without jeopardizing their good reputation. So that's all from me. I'll pass it to the next presenter.
My name is Amir Tasha, and let's proceed with the current issue of whistleblowing. One of the most efficient ways to detect and prevent corruption and other forms of wrongdoing is by whistleblowing. The value of whistleblowers for our society is frequently demonstrated by the scandals they expose and the long-term reform that exists bring about. Although the Whistleblowers Protection Act exists, most of the time these whistleblowers were not protected and were attacked and harassed, especially in Malaysia, particularly when the case involves people with high position. This is because there is not much awareness spread regarding whistleblowing. And as an initiative to it, World Whistleblowers Day is commended on June 23rd consistently as to celebrate the courage individuals who come forward to report corruption and to share some of the way to help them achieve justice. Besides that, in response to the Malaysian government's announcement of modification to the Whistleblowers Protection Act 2010 in November 2021, anti-corruption groups argue key elements in Malaysia legislation must be promptly updated or perhaps abolished to give better protection for whistleblowers. On top of that, as an initiative to spread awareness on whistleblowing, some firms in Malaysia conduct whistleblowing programs to provide channel for their employees to disclose any misconduct activities. For instance, OCBC Bank conducts an OCBC whistleblowing program which aspire to foster an atmosphere that is honest, ethical and fair for their customers, employees and shareholders. Their policy provides an outlet for all OCBC users to report any improper activity by OCBC employees in accordance with the processes outlined in this program, as well as to provide assurance that any information submitted by the whistleblower will be treated in strict confidence without fear of retaliation. And the channel is available on their website for those who want to whistleblow, as which makes it easier for people to make the report. Apart from OCBC Bank, Malaysia Airport Berhad also conducts its own whistleblowing program. MAHB expects their staffs and others that they deal with who have genuine concerns about any aspect of MAHB's operation to come forward and voice those concerns. MAHB has a whistleblowing policy to aid the company in dealing with allegations of wrongdoing covered by the policy. So all in all, I could say whistleblowing awareness does still need to be spread, as Malaysians still lacks of this awareness regarding this issue. Governments and as well as private firms should come hands in hand in spreading the awareness on whistleblowing programs and highlighting the importance of whistleblowing along with the protection of the whistleblower will get. I guess that's all from me. Thank you. I'll pass the presentation to the next presenter.
I will proceed with the conclusion. Notably, the professions of internal auditors are currently evolving and become one of the most vital roles in any organizations. Most organizations have broadened their responsibility beyond the regulatory compliance issue due to the new demands of internal auditing profession. Such new responsibility includes the needs for internal auditor to perform internal whistleblowing policy procedure for any corporate wrongdoings or governance misconduct within the organization. This is important to make sure that the transparency of the business can be maintained and also to protect the public interest. Nonetheless, it is undeniable that there is still a lack of awareness regarding the whistleblowing policies within the public. Therefore, the enhancement of policy, especially in terms of the protections of whistleblowers' identity, should be instantaneous and enforced by every party involved. Relating to the case of Cahaya Mata Sarawak Berhad, it can be concluded that the whistleblowing policy practiced by the company is effective, since it is complying with the high standards of ethical requirement. That is all from our group. Thank you.